Jaina versus Jaina.
You asked for it.
Oh, it is on.
Powering up! Portals online!
I am ready!
Something needs tinkering?
For Nazata.
Flame on!
I wonder.
I am ready.
Something needs tinkering?
Thank you.
Hello.
Versus Gul'dan!
Your soul shall be mine!
You asked for it. Hello.
I greet you.
My shield for Argus!
Why do you call? I have big plans.
My shield for Argus!
The artifact. Out on me.
secrets.
Buying or selling?
Why do you call? Get in there and fight, maggot!
Who dares summon me?
Jaina versus Jaina!
You asked for it.
Oh, it is on.
I wonder. What to do? What to do? Hello. Runs out on me. Whoops. Hello.
Your turn to fall!
Time runs out on me.
Jaina versus Jaina!
You asked for it.
Oh, it is on.
Thank you.
Powering up! Portals online!
aunt is in the way.
Recently, Hearthstone patch 4.2.0 was released. And yes, This is the right time to comment about the name and number of the patch. Well, the big change is the thing that everyone's asked for 2 years. It's finally in. Now, there is a button. After 2 years of hard research, we've discovered that the best way to make this Hearthstone deck screen go to 9 more deck slots is a handy button right there and there. It used to be here and here, which probably would have also worked, but I'm sure that ample market testing has decided that this is the right place for it. And now you can have 18 decks. Wow. You might have noticed that this button, Wild, can now be clicked. So that's how you're going to end up changing from Wild to Standard. When the new expansion comes out and when Standard comes out, that's how you're going to rotate between Standard and Wild. I actually don't think that's very clear, but everyone's going to be Wild by default and you can just change it to Standard. Here's a small thing too while we're at it. So when you're on the play screen, you can now press My Collection to go make a deck. And then when you're done making the deck, you can just press back and go back to play, saving you 3 clicks, because normally you would have to go from My Collection, then press back, and then press play. Now it saves you 2 clicks. But that's a value 2-click save. Back in my day, when you needed to make a new deck in Solo Adventures, and you had just lost to an unfair boss, here's the usual process you'd do. You'd go to My Collection, you'd build a deck, you'd press back, 1 click, you'd go to Solo Adventures, 2 clicks, you'd go to this thing, sometimes if this isn't selected you have to select that, 3 clicks, you choose that, 4 clicks, press choose, 5 clicks, you click on the boss, 6 clicks, you press choose, 7 clicks, but hey, now, all you have to do is just go My Collection, build your deck, and then press back, and then there you are. Brilliant. It shows the 18 decks over here as well. The slider goes all the way down here. Wow. Incredible. Speaking of new deck technology, now whenever you make a new deck, there's some deck recipes going on. There's some pre-constructed decks which aren't as good as decks that you can look up, but they're a really good baseline starting way to go, especially the classic ones. These classic decks just generally have good cards in them and are actually really good ways to start, similar to how I would build some basic decks myself. So I think that's a really good way to start off learning without just throwing you into the starting completely fresh. And if you don't have all the cards, the game is more intelligent in suggesting replacements. For example, I actually don't own Prophet Valen. If I click replace cards here, it's going to decide to replace Prophet Valen with a big card, like perhaps Emperor Thoris or Argent Commander. There's a bit of randomness in this. I don't think these two cards are as good as the cards initially replaced it with the first time I had it. Like, hey, Dr. Boom, that's a good replacement. Or Ragnaros, that's a good replacement. Baron Geten, that's probably pretty decent too. So, Strike with the Shadows. A Face Priest deck. Brilliant. The deck recipes, along with, of course, being a good resource for having a quick baseline deck to build, also give a little bit of a hint on what cards might be nerfed coming up. For example, Classic Druid is notably missing Ancient of Lore, which would have been thought of as a really good classic card to put in an Ancient deck. It is also notably missing Force of Nature Savage Roar. In Ferocious Beasts, there's only one Savage Roar in this deck and no Force of Nature. And in Overwhelming Numbers, there are 2 Savage Roar but no Force of Nature, which is a card that you would have expected to be put into a deck with a lot of cards in it to have Force of Nature and Savage Roar. Other hints that have been kind of here and there are in Classic Handluck, there's no Owl, even though there are 2 Ancient Watchers. Owl is a card that has been hypothesized as possibly being limiting in scope. because it just so overall handled so many cards. Notably, there's a big game hunter in this deck, though. There's also now new cool ways to search for cards. For example, one thing that's long been asked for is searching for golden cards. So now you can disenchant some golden cards if you wish to. For example, I'm about to make a bank by disenchanting my useless Dalaran Mage. That's actually basic. But I'm about to make bank by disenchanting my Light's Champion, which is golden. That's 100 dust in the bank, yeah. And if the new expansion comes up with some brilliant demon that needs Light's Champion, then too bad for me. Other cool things you can search for now include health colon 6, or any number, and then you can find all the minions in the game that have 6 health. You can even do health colon 6 to 8, and then you'll get everything that has a health of between 6 and 8. That also counts for attack, 1, or attack, that's useful for a hobgoblin, or attack 1, 2, 3, or you can do mana 4 to 7, or like very useful to do like 6 to 7, I guess, to see all your big cards which aren't huge, or 6 to 10, and then that's when you can look up all the cool stuff at the end. Now, if you really want to get fancy, and there's going to be a official Blizzard release on all these search terms that you can do, you can mix and match the searches with something like attack 2 and health 2, and then you can find every minion in the game that's a 2/2. And then like mana 3, and then you get all the 3 mana 2/2s. Incredible technology. Another small search note. Sometimes I searched for Alexstrasza. Now type in Alex, because who knows how to spell Alexstrasza, right? And then all these random cards would come up because turns out that a guy named Alex made a lot of these cards. But now it just comes with Alexstrasza's champion, Alex, probably how you wanted to have it. But don't worry, if you still want to search for all the beautiful art made by Alex Horley Orlandelli, you can search for artist colon Alex. And then that pesky Alexstrasza card doesn't come up. Well, Alex has made a few cards there. In the crafting screen, you can also search for missing and note all the cards that you are missing. And I myself have mostly a full collection at this point, except the really bad cards. And Malagus, which I have a legendary version of. Now you can also disenchant cards from adventures. So if you've done Naxxramas, and there are some cards here that you think will never see the light of play, such as Myxna, then you can get your free 400 Gust. Nice. That also counts for cards from the recent expansions. I believe for the recent expansions, though, you cannot craft them still until you've actually gotten the adventure. So make sure you don't disenchant something that you'll later regret, and then you'll have to craft it again. But hey, if you need that 400 dust, Majordomo is possibly your man. We've also got a new hero portrait in here.
I will serve for Shatrath.
Or a new hero, I should say. Lady Liadrin, who is obtained by leveling up a new World of Warcraft character up to 20, so old ones don't count. And I believe if you have someone who's level 19 just laying around and you gain the level, then you will also get Lady Liadrin. So that's a cool cross-promotion. It's free to get the free trial of World of Warcraft, which will be enough to get you to level 20.
My hammer burns with holy fire! My sincerest thanks. Well played. Ah, hello, challenger.
Ah, apologies. An error, to be sure.
You will pay for that, cur! Burn!
Options. Should I...
Let's move!
Your win, friend. I concede.
This batch is also a little bit of a preparation for making sure that there's even more notification that Standard is coming in soon. So Goblins vs. Gnomes has a notification that it's leaving the shop soon, so that newer players aren't going to make the mistake of buying these packs if they want to play Standard. As well as in Adventure, Naxxramas is leaving the shop soon, because when Standard rolls around, when the new expansion comes out late April, early May, then Naxxramas and Goblins vs. Gnomes will not be in Standard. Along the same lines of promotions, that Whispers of the Old Gods is now in the shop. You can get 50 packs for $49.99, which is the fancy marketing term to make you think that's under $50. Along with the packs, you get the really cool card back, one of the best card backs they've done. Very creepy. One of the unmarked patch note changes is Reno Jackson now has a gold border around it when you can play it. So here I am in the Shaman Arena, and I have two Totem Golems in the deck, but since I've already played one, Reno Jackson is golden. So, cool. Another one of the patch changes, kind of unannounced and very subtle, is that whenever you pick an arena card, the sound effect is much less pronounced. Instead of the clang, it's more of a ting. So if you were wondering what that huge 1+ gigabyte patch was for, that's all the small things and a few optimization things probably, and inserting a few new brawls. For example, Rafam versus... crap, I forgot the name. Rafam versus Kel'Thuzad. Coming soon. Top deck's bad and I didn't get the healing totem. Oh, that's bad for me. This guy's got a really solid deck too. A lot of strong minions. Like, all the minions have been very efficient. Could be a close finish. So he's got 10. I need to just put every point of damage I can on him, I think. I don't know if I should horse ride the 3-2. I should horse ride the 3-2. It's either that or face. I'm gonna hit this, though. Good spit.
Did you bring some fish?
Nice.
Get in there, fight, maggot. Ready to ride.
Tap. Oh. He has 3, 6, 8, 11. Alright, so obviously I have to do that. Reno Jackson! Oh. Origin Commander. That's too bad. This game was actually close enough that maybe my missed Frostal Forelord plus one would have cost me the game. Maybe. I actually really want to play this 3 into this 2, right? Yeah, because I don't have a 4, and I'll never have a 4. But this is such a weak card to play. But it's either this into... Yeah, so I have to do this. Or Totem! Well, that's probably better than Totem. Do I want to save a 1-2 or 2-1? Next turn I'll have 4 mana. I could also press this button and then try to go for the healing totem. Then next turn I have 5 mana, which is good. This is a 3-4, which is good. Next turn I'll play a 3. Suppose he plays something that has 5 health for 4 mana. I feel like this is a question right now of tempo versus... This is a question of tempo versus value. A 2-1 is better than a 1-2. But a 2-1 can be Fire Blast. But if he plays a 2-drop, he's starting to lose the game anyways. I think a long time ago I would have traded the 2-1 in, but I'm going to trade in the 1-2.
Knowledge is power, and I know a lot.
Way back when. I certainly would have done it the other way around. Did you bring some fish? Since this 3 plus 2 deals with the 5 then. Oh, nice one. Rewarded. Really good torch. I'm gonna set the stage for a huge Frostal Forelord. You could already get a pretty good one. But there's no better time to play Regent then, before Flame Strike's possible. And on an empty board. And now when I do this plus Warlord.
Reporting for duty.
It'll be quite good. Good deal. Been a while since I've had the awesome 10-10-ness.
Your magic shall not save me.
Shall I just Horse Rider the face? Or shall I play Mercenary? I think I shall play Mercenary. At this point, it is a question of overcommitting against Flamestrike. Or not a question, but a commentary on. This card plus that card, though.
Don't worry, Lux. The cavalry's here.
Yeah!
The battle
for the whole charged.
Okay, so I'm a little rusty. A little bit. But casual miss, 3 damage. But I played around Flamestrike with Silent Knight. Kind of. I also forgot about my Rockbiter Doomhammer possible synergy. That's true. Oh, the punish. Wait, actually, I still win. 2, 4, 6, 13. Alright, we're good.
Silence.
Well played.
How you doing?
Okay. The good news is the Rockbiter would have just gotten counterspelled. And I missed a little bit of damage earlier, but you know, it's all good. It's all good.
You asked for it.
For Doomhammer.
Alright, so Pharaoh's Spirit isn't always keep in this deck. That's a 2-drop, but I don't really want to play that on 2. Tend into the Spirit, into the Totem Golem, into how much mana will I have? I'll have 4. It's bad form to Totem Golem on turn 4, because then I'll have 4 mana again. Unless I get lucky and draw Sengen. This is a really good setup, though. If he has nothing this turn, I can play the Lieutenant. You play something that threatens Lieutenant. And you play Feral Spirit to protect.
Hello.
Quick consideration on the Mech Warper, but it's not as good. So I'll play Mech Warper on turn 4, and then turn 5 will be this. And then I overload into 5 again, which is really good. Shall I clear the board? I think so. Although I can just deal 7 to him right now. And what's the real cost of it? Why would I clear the board? He's gonna attack with the 3-5 into the 2-3 anyways. I'm just missing 7 damage. I'm gonna hit the face. Yeah, let's hit the face. Yeah. Okay, there's a slight punishment that I can get, but, well, not even slight. He just hits a wolf, and then he frostbolts a wolf or something. Or tortures a wolf. I mean, this is...
I'm ready to learn.
Kinda lucky for me. Kinda lucky, kinda... Yeah, mostly lucky. Kinda lucky. Sorta lucky. Yeah, hit the 1-1 and then the 3-3. Test for the, thing with this thing. Okay, that's pretty good for that. If that were to... Nice. Heh, yeah. Fallen Knight didn't get hit. Pretty lucky. Oh, those are zero mana. I am ready to learn. Wisp value. Wow, that's a good draw. The Frost Wolves stand ready. I can clear the 5-4 if I want. If I simply hit face, he can clear my 7-7. Silence. Alright, this looks like a better deal. I did think about the face, believe me, I did. Wanted, dead or alive. Revives, please. Curse. So at least if he flame strikes, he takes double Curse of Rafam damage, right? Possible lethal on several fronts. Spell damage is lethal. No lethal. Hurry up. Portal online. Want it? So this next turn I have like double chance to get the... I should go to Scar Totemic before Totem because it'll reduce the chance that I don't get my spell damage totem. Or that. Okay. The Tuskar on the last turn gives me a 2-8 flame tying and spell damage. But, if I save it for this turn, I get to press the totem button twice. I think the overall chance goes up.
Oh shoot, I forgot to press record. Okay, okay, we're recording now. God damn it. That was nearly really bad. Alright. Alright, as Jurdrake, hello, that is a no-brainer. So far is also a no-brainer. Gnomish is usually a little bit better. Coral is really good. Fort Call is really good. DID and Flame, oh my god, that's really good. I think DID is just more unique, actually. I have big plans. Nah, Alchemist is fine. Direwolf or Boldfist Ogre, both pretty good. Direwolf does have synergy with Crazed Alchemist, a little bit. Boldfist Ogre. Oh, I'll take Boldfist. It's like a unique card, right? When I draft Arena, it has to be like uniqueness first, right? For example, like, the uniqueness of a 3-5 Violet Teacher is not unique, right? Because like, you can always draft a 4 mana 3-5. But the thing is, like, Microtrotech is a unique effect, you know? That's usually how I draft. Like, you know, be more versatile, right? Power of a Woman is, like, super unique. Dark Bargain is pretty good. Blood Knight is also really good with all the Paladins roaming around. And Ginny is just a 4-6, so this is probably bad. So it's either Blood Knight or Dark Bargain. I think I'm gonna go with Blood Knight. Just, like, too many Paladins, you know? Ooh, these all suck. I think the one that sucks the least. So there, right? So you want those, you want those drafts to be like this. Because, like, sometimes you get three bad choices and you have to pick a 2-mana, 2-3 anyways, right? So, like, that's kind of how it happens. What happens? Your ability to restart is unique. Well, screw you, Mr. Ondefro. Alright. Emperor, right? Although we do have a Drake. Oh, well, then it's Arena. People don't draft legendaries. What am I saying? Alright, let's do Emperor. There's, like, no choice here. Yeah. Sense Demons. I'd rather Silent Knight, huh? Evil Heckler's good. It's fine. Huge Toad is also pretty fine. But Evil Heckler's pretty good. Nah, Huge Toad is fine too. Ah, god damn it. I'll do Huge Toad. Flame Imp, holo. Hellfire, holo. Oh my god, Skittles! Why you gotta be paired of Hellfire? I can't pick you. Zombie Chow's really good. Doomguard for sure. Oh, Shadow Flame. Oh my god. I have to pick Doomguard, right? Void Caller, Doomguard Synergy. Oh, this Aelia is so good, but nah. Shredder is really good. I can't pick Hellfire! Yo, stop! They're like putting two good cards together. I hate those. Champion's fine. Dark Bomb's really good. Argus is really good. Fearsome Doomguard is fine, since I have a Void Caller. I do like Abusive a lot. But, yeah. Gotta have some activators, you know. Another Hellfire is fine. Harvest is really good. Cult Master or Coil? This deck does not... This deck draws pretty damn well for a Warlock deck. We have a Zurdrake with Gnomish and we have two Coils. So like, it already draws really, really well. We're definitely gonna draw one more card, but like, it's either Coil or Cult Master. I think we're gonna go with the Coil. Yeah, Coil seems a little bit better here. Silverhand Knight is definitely the pick here. Just double checking. Archmage is really good with Mortal Coil. But... Oh, we could go Sheep as well. We have three Coils. We could Coil our Sheep and deal like 2 damage to the board. Not that I really care about that, right? Because I have Hellfire anyways. I have 2 Hellfires. Like, I don't need any more AoEs. I need like more Substance. Substance means like playable cards. So like things you can just drop down no matter what and they're good. So yeah, I think Silverhand Knight is better. Ancient Watcher, I have only one activator. Pyromancer is fine. Light's Champion is... Ugh. I guess Pyromancer, we need another 2 drop. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and a lot of small dudes. Alright, it's fine. Alright, no Peddlers. But we have, we do have the Void Caller Synergy, we do have card draw, and we do have pretty good, you know, defensive mechanisms in case we 4 hit behind, so... Yeah, okay. I think this is fine. Oh, was there like daylight savings time? Was there daylight savings? Am I 1 hour early, guys? I think I am. I will fight. Oh, there's daylight savings time. Or am I 1 hour late? Wait, am I 1 hour early or am I 1 hour late? I know there was daylight savings. Oh, daylight savings time is so stupid. I wish I could like hold daylight savings time and crush it. You know, like just crush it. It's so stupid. Oh, I'm 1 hour late. Oh my god. No wonder. I was wondering, like, what's up, you know? Oh, it's 1 hour early? Wait, what? Oh my god, I'm just confused now. You guys are silly monkeys. Let's vote. Oh wait, it's not a vote. It's either a yes or no. What the hell? Okay. Let's do the pyro. This is twinning. The only punish is no punish. Great, Argent Protector. Argent Protector is not even a punish. You're on time? No, I'm not on time. There was daylight saving sometime. It was like, your phone automatically changed, so you're on time. Yeah. But the thing is, like, I don't know if I'm 1 hour early or 1 hour late. Because, like, I'm good at math. I think I'm 1 hour early, actually. To be honest. I think I'm 1 hour early. I'm just gonna keep on saying that until I believe it. The clocks jump forward an hour, right? So if the clocks jump for an hour, and I start... Oh, that means I'm 1 hour late. I don't know. For Hong Kong time, you're early. Okay, that makes sense then. You know what? Yeah, I'm just gonna refer to Hong Kong time. Because Hong Kong time is not dumb. Alright, Dark Iron Dwarf is fine here, right? I mean, it's not fine. It's pretty bad, but... I mean, it just trades with this, which is kind of sad, actually. You know what? I think I'm gonna go with Gnomish. Because, like, if he trades this, I can just Hellfire next turn, just lives. Plus, I get a coil. So, this should be right. I do value the Dark Iron Dwarf pretty high. Oh, he trades anyways. MC Tech is pretty good. Nah, I kind of want Drake. Okay. I'm cantripping very, very hardly, so that's good. Amaz, are you gonna do a video about the new cards? Yeah, I think I'm gonna do one new video about the new cards every, like, Friday or something. I think that might be right. I'm not sure. Okay. Hellfire seems really good here. Yeah, Hellfire seems, like, insane here. So let's do that. As you can see, Coral is always, always relevant. One of the most high-tier cards in the arena, to be honest. Like, one mana deal one and draw a card? Oh my god. Oh god. Okay, well, Dark Iron Dwarf is super good here. As you can see. As you can tell. A one drop just killed a seven drop. That's value, you know? It's value. Oh, perfect, I am early, guys. Yay, everybody goes Amaz early. Thank you, Amaz, for being early. Yeah, okay. Thank you. You're welcome. Reporting for duty. Blizzard released the 5 Silverhand Recruits card. Yeah, the 5 mana recruit cards is actually much worse than Muster for Battle. Like, much, much worse. None may steal our souls. Shields up. Red alert. Beautiful.
Glory to the Sindora.
I think I'm ever gonna use that card. So now we have what? 10? 16? 16 plus 8 is 24. Wait, 24 damage out of our hat. Insane. Hey, Voku! How are you doing? Voku for the win.
Great artisans say,
The more the teapot is used, the more beautiful it becomes. The pot is seasoned by repeatedly pouring tea over the surface. The deposit left on the clay creates this beautiful patina over time. Some pots, the clay has been burnished by tea made over 400 years ago.
This museum will be closing in 10
minutes. 400 years old. They're letting you use it to make yourself a brew.
Some things aren't supposed to sit behind glass. They're made to be touched, to be handled. These pots need attention. The clay is cracking.
Well, I can't see how a tiny splash of tea is going to help.
Sometimes you have to look hard at something to see its value. See? This one shines a little brighter.
I don't suppose, I don't suppose that you want to have a drink. Not tea, obviously. In a pub with me tonight.
You wouldn't like me all that much.
Couldn't I maybe decide that for myself?
I can't. I'm sorry. Please stop asking.
Is there security? Hello?
Unexpected item in bagging area. Please try again. Item not scanned. Please try again.
I think you can keep your voice down.
Card not authorized.
Yes,
please
all right.
Use an
I've got
alternative
it.
Method of payment. Card not authorized. Please use an alternative
it.
Method
Keep
of
it.
Payment.
Keep that.
You took your time.
Yeah, I didn't get the shopping.
What? Why not?
Because I had a row in the shop with a chip and pin machine.
You had a row with a machine?
Sort of. It sat there and I shouted abuse. Have you got cash?
Take my card.
You could always go yourself. You know, you've been sitting there all morning. You're not even moved since I left. Well, what happened about that case you were offered, the Jarrier Diamond?
Not interested. I sent them a message.
Don't worry about me, I can manage. Is that my computer?
Of course.
What?
Mine is in the bedroom.
What, and you couldn't be bothered to get up? It's password protected.
In a manner of speaking, took me less than a minute to guess yours. Not exactly Fort Knox.
Right, thank you. Oh. Need to get a job?
Oh, dull.
Listen, if you'd be able to lend me some... Sherlock, you listening?
I need to go to the bank.
When you said we were going to the bank.
Sherlock Holmes.
Sherlock Holmes.
Sebastian.
How are you, buddy? How long has it been? 8 years since I last clapped eyes on you?
This is my friend, John Watson.
Friend?
Colleague.
Oh. Right.
Grab a pew. You need anything? Coffee? Water?
No.
No? We're all sorted here, thanks.
So, you're doing well. You've been abroad a lot.
Well, some.
Flying all the way around the world twice in a month.
Right. You're doing that thing. Man, we were at uni together. This guy here had a trick he used to do.
It's not a trick.
He could look at you and tell you your whole life story.
Yes, I've seen him do it.
Put the wind up, everybody. We hated him. He'd come down to breakfast in the formal hall, and this freak would know you'd been shagging the previous night.
I simply observed.
But go on, enlighten me. Two trips a month, flying all the way around the world? You're quite right. How could you tell? You're going to tell me there was a stain on my tie from some special kind of ketchup you can only buy in Manhattan?
No,
maybe I... Maybe it was the mud on my shoes.
I was just chatting with your secretary outside. She told me.
I'm glad you could make it over. We've had a break-in.
Sir William's office, bank's former chairman. The room's been left here like a sort of memorial. Someone broke in late last night.
What did they steal?
Nothing. Just left a little message. Few seconds apart. So, someone came up here in the middle of the night, splashed paint around, and left within a minute.
How many ways into that office?
Well, that's where this gets really interesting.
Every door that opens in this bank, it gets locked right here. Every walk-in cupboard, every toilet.
That door didn't open last night.
There's a hole in our security. Find it and we'll pay you. Five figures. And this is an advance. Tell me how you got in. There's a bigger one on its way.
I don't need an incentive, Sebastian.
He's kidding you, obviously. Shall I look after that for him? Thanks. 2 trips around the world this month. You didn't ask his secretary. You said that just to irritate him. How did you know?
Did you see his watch?
His watch?
Time is right, but the date was wrong. It said 2 days ago. Crossed the date line twice, but he didn't alter it.
Within a month, how'd you get that part?
New brightening. It'll come out this February.
OK. So do you think we should sniff around here for a bit longer?
Got everything I need to know already, thanks.
Hmm?
That graffiti was a message. Someone at the bank, working on the trading floors. We find the intended recipient and...
They'll lead us to the person who sent it?
Obvious.
Well, there's 300 people up there. Who was it meant for?
Pillars.
What?
Pillars and the screens. Very few places you could see that graffiti from. That narrows the field considerably. And of course, the message was left at 11:34 last night. That tells us a lot.
Does it?
Traders come to work at all hours. Some trade with Hong Kong in the middle of the night. That message was intended for somebody who came in at midnight. Not many Van Coons in the phone book. Taxi!
So what do we do now? Sit here and wait for him to come back?
Just moved in.
What?
Floor above, new label.
Could have just replaced it.
No one ever does that.
Hello?
Hi. I live in the flat just below you. I don't think we've met.
No, well, I've just moved in.
Actually, I've just locked my keys in my flat.
You want me to buzz you in?
Yeah. And can I use your balcony?
What?
Sherlock, you okay? Yeah, anytime you feel like letting me in. Do you think he'd lost a lot of money? I mean, suicide is pretty common among city boys.
We don't know that it was suicide.
Come on. The door was locked from the inside. You had to climb down the balcony.
Been away 3 days, judging by the laundry. Look at the case. There was something tightly packed inside it.
Thanks, I'll take your word for it.
Problem?
Yeah, I'm not desperate to root around some bloke's dirty underwear.
Those symbols at the bank, the graffiti, why were they put there?
Some sort of code?
Obviously. Why were they painted? You want to communicate, why not use email?
Well, maybe he wasn't answering.
Oh, could you follow?
Nope.
What kind of a message would everyone try to avoid?
What about this morning?
Those letters you were looking at.
Bells?
Yes. He was being threatened.
Bag this up, will you? And,
not by the gas board.
See if you can get prints off this glass.
Ah, Sergeant. We haven't met.
Yeah, I know who you are, and I'd prefer it if you didn't tamper with any of the evidence.
I phoned Lestrade. Is he on his way?
He's busy. I'm in charge. And it's not Sergeant, it's Detective Inspector Dimmock. We're obviously looking at a suicide.
It does seem the only explanation of all the facts.
Wrong.
It's one possible explanation of some of the facts. You've got a solution that you like, but you're choosing to ignore anything you see that doesn't comply with it.
Like?
The wound's on the right side of his head.
And?
Van Coon was left-handed.
requires quite a bit of contortion.
Left-handed?
I'm amazed you didn't notice. All you have to do is look around this flat. Coffee table on the left-hand side, coffee mug handle pointing to the left. Power sockets, habitually use the ones on the left. Pen and paper on the left-hand side of the phone because he picked it up with his right and took down messages with his left. You want me to go on?
No, I think you've covered
it. I might as well. I'm almost at the bottom of the list. There's a knife on the breadboard with butter on the right side of the blade. Because he used it with his left, it's highly unlikely that a left-handed man would shoot himself in the right side of his head. Conclusion, someone broke in here and murdered him. Only explanation of all of the facts.
But the gun...
He was waiting for the killer. He'd been threatened.
What?
Today at the bank, sort of a warning.
He fired a shot when his attacker came in.
And the bullet?
Went through the open window.
Oh, come on. What are the chances of that?
Went to you to get the ballistics report. Bullet in his brain wasn't fired from his gun, I guarantee it.
But if his door was locked from the inside, how did the killer get in?
Good. You're finally asking the right questions.
He's left trying to sort of cut his hair with a fork, which of course could never be done.
It was a threat. That's what the graffiti meant.
I'm kind of in a meeting. Can you make an appointment with my secretary?
I don't think this can wait. Sorry, Sebastian. One of your traders, someone who works in your office, was killed.
What?
Van Koon. The police are at his flat.
Killed?
Sorry to interfere with everyone's digestion. Still want to make an appointment? Would maybe 9 o'clock at Scotland Yard suit?
Harrow, Oxford. Very bright guy. Worked in Asia for a while, sir.
You gave him the Hong Kong accounts.
Lost 5 mil in a single morning, made it all back a week later. That was a steal, lady, huh?
You'd want to kill him?
We'll make enemies.
You don't all end up with a bullet through your temple.
Not usually. Excuse me.
It's my chairman. Police have been on to him. Apparently they're telling him it was a suicide.
Well, they've got it wrong, Sebastian. He was murdered.
Well, I'm afraid they don't see it like that.
Sir.
And neither does my boss. I hired you to do a job. Don't get sidetracked.
I thought bankers were all supposed to be heartless bastards.
I need you to get over to Crispian's. 2 Ming vases up for auction. Chenghua. Will you appraise them?
Su Lin should go. She's the expert.
Su Lin has resigned her job. I need you.
Just locum work.
No, that's fine.
You're a bit overqualified.
I could always do with the money.
Well, we've got 2 away on holiday this week, and one's just left to have a baby. Might be a bit mundane for you.
No, mundane is good sometimes. Mundane works.
It says here you're a soldier.
And a doctor.
Anything else you can do?
Learn the clarinet at school.
Oh, I look forward to it.
I said, could you pass me a pen?
What, when?
About an hour ago.
Didn't notice I'd gone out then. I went to see about a job at that surgery.
How was it?
Great. She's great.
Who?
The job.
She?
It.
Yeah, have a look.
The intruder who can walk through walls.
Happened last night. Journalist shot dead in his flat. Doors locked, windows bolted from the inside, exactly the same as Van Koon.
God, you think?
He's killed another one. Brian Lucas, freelance journalist, murdered in his flat. Doors locked from the inside.
You've got to admit it's similar. Both men killed by someone who can walk through solid walls.
Inspector, do you seriously believe that Eddie Van Koon was just another city suicide? You have seen the ballistics report, I suppose. And the shot that killed him, was it fired from his own gun?
No.
No. So this investigation might move a bit quicker if you were to take my word as gospel. I've just handed you a murder inquiry. 5 minutes in his flat. Safe. Put a chain across the door, bolt it shut, think they're impregnable. They don't reckon for 1 second that there's another way in.
Well, I don't understand.
Dealing with a killer who can climb.
What are you doing?
Clings to the walls like an insect. That's how he got in.
What?
Climbed up the side of the walls, ran along the roof, dropped in through this skylight.
You're not serious. Like Spider-Man.
He scaled 6 floors of a Docklands apartment building, jumped the balcony to kill Van Koon.
Oh, hold on.
And of course, that's how he got into the bank. He ran along the window ledge and onto the terrace.
I have to find out what connects these two men. Stamped on the book is the same day that he died. Sherlock. So, the killer goes to the bank, leaves a threatening cipher for Van Koon. Van Koon panics, returns to his apartment, locks himself in. Hours later, he dies.
The killer finds Lucas at the library. He writes the cipher on the shelf where he knows it'll be seen. Lucas goes home.
Late that night, he dies too.
Why did they die, Sherlock?
Only the cipher can tell us.
The world's run on codes and ciphers, John. From the £1 million security system at the bank to the PIM machine you took exception to, cryptography inhabits our every waking moment.
Yes, okay, but...
But it's all computer-generated, electronic codes, electronic ciphering methods. This is different. It's an ancient device. Modern code-breaking methods won't unravel it.
Where are we headed?
I need to ask some advice.
What? Sorry?
You heard me perfectly. I'm not saying it again.
You need advice?
I'm painting, yes. I need to talk to an expert.
part of my new exhibition.
Interesting.
Call it Urban Bloodlust Frenzy.
Catchy.
I've got 2 minutes before a community support officer comes round that corner. Can we do this while I'm working?
Know the author?
Recognise the paint. It's like Michigan, hardcore propellant. Say zinc.
What about the symbols? Do you recognise them?
Not even sure it's a proper language.
Two men have been murdered, Raz. Deciphering this is the key to finding out who killed them.
Well, this is all you got to go on. It's hardly much now, is it?
Are you going to help us or not?
I'll ask around.
Somebody must know something about it.
Oi! What the hell do you think you're doing? This gallery is a listed public building.
No, no, wait, wait. It's not me who painted that. I was just holding this for...
A bit of an enthusiast, are we?
She was right in the middle of an important piece of restoration. Why would she suddenly resign?
Family problems, she said so in her letter.
But she doesn't have a family. She came to this country on her own.
Andy.
Look, those teapots, those ceramics, they've become her obsession. She's been working on restoring them for weeks. I can't believe that she would just abandon them.
Perhaps she was getting a bit of unwanted attention.
Been a while.
Yeah, well, you know how it is. Custody sergeants don't really like to be hurried, do they? Just formalities. Fingerprints, charge sheet, and I've got to be in magistrate's court on Tuesday.
What?
Me, Sherlock, in court on Tuesday. They're giving me an ASBO.
Good, fine.
You want to tell your little pal he's welcome to go and own up any time?
This symbol, I still can't place it.
Hey, Vogel, you wanna, like, grab lunch sometime? Like, Lala Po is actually in town, so we can actually, like, go eat.
Reporting for duty.
But then you have work, I guess, huh? Alright, GG, right? 10, 12, 16, 18, 18. Yeah, this thing is good. It's just that I would like one or two peddlers. If I get one or two peddlers, it's, like, so good. So, me and Max, you know Max, guys, right? You know Max, the Dota manager-ish kind of guy. We actually, I was like, oh, Max, do you want to buy shoes with me? Because my feet is, like, growing bigger, you know? It's like, my shoes don't fit my feet anymore. And he was like, yeah, okay, it's a date. It's like, okay. Okay, I really don't like help. I'll just keep Pyro, I think. Need to be more versatile, if you get what I mean. And then I guess we're going to lunch too. So it's actually pretty early, like 12:30. Like Lalapo, like Lalapo is free like after 3. Like 3 for lunch, so it's kind of like a brunch kind of thing. So, Yeah, you want to eat breakfast, I think tomorrow. And then we'll go and get lunch at like 3 or something.
A voice acting role in Oddworld Soulstorm, the recently announced game from Oddworld Inhabitants. It's a great joy for me to be able to say that as someone who grew up with the Oddworld games and considers them very important to my formative years as an enjoyer, a connoisseur of the art of interactive entertainment. So I'm incredibly pleased with that, and that is some wonderful news that certainly wasn't overshadowed by any other news this week. So let's focus on that, the important news, the only news about me this week worth paying attention to. Nintendo had some Star Fox Zero news this past week, and let's just say that the world of real hardcore gamers was in an uproar. The latest scoop is that the newest Star Fox will feature an optional invincible mode designed for inexperienced players, allowing literal babies to be able to play and enjoy the game with a Star Fox Zero risk of death. Star Fox Zero risk. The reaction? Disgust and anger in equal measure. I hate games, wrote one lamenting responder. I hate how Nintendo has a toddler option on all their newer games. Something like SFZ will only be bought by hardcore fans. Lol, what? Decried another. That's kind of pathetic. Why play a game you can't lose? For some reason, this makes me sad. If you can't lose, what's the point? What sense of accomplishment can you feel? One commenter stated, I don't know why games should be made that autoplay themselves. What's the point? Are people really that incapable of any sort of difficulty? So what if a player struggles? It's the only way they'll get good. The news has been called embarrassing, criticized as a wimp mode or don't even try mode, hand-holding for babies, and a slew of other things that I'm too much of a gentleman to repeat. People are furious at this, as they were furious at the idea of recent Mario games introducing invincible Tanuki suits after a certain amount of deaths, as they were furious when Ocarina of Time 3D was dumbed down. The idea of games featuring optional easier modes somehow triggers an instinctive lashing out among the more zealous of the hardcore gamer set, and for as many times as I've witnessed the frothing fury, I've never gotten a step closer toward properly understanding it. What exactly is so harmful about a completely optional mode that you never have to experience? I mean, we've had this discussion before with same-sex romance options in RPGs, and it's no less inane here. I mean, it shouldn't affect your enjoyment of the game, knowing that I'm somewhere out there sitting in the corner of my room looking at Iron Bull and just pounding it, you know? Pounding it. Pounding it. Pounding it. Pounding it! What is so horrific about this idea that something exists in a game for somebody who isn't you? How selfish do you have to be to demand that a game caters to your desires and only to your desires, excluding anybody else? Is that the only way you can enjoy a game, if you're the only fucker who can enjoy it? So literal babies can play Star Fox Zero now. So the fuck what? Nobody's saying you're a baby, though I guess they could if you're whining about an optional feature in a video game, but seriously, it's not a commentary on your precious skills as a hardcore gamer that somebody can play the same game as you on an easier setting. It seems utterly loopy to me that you'd enjoy Star Fox Zero less if someone who isn't you doesn't get to die in it. You know who else couldn't have fun unless someone else died? Ted Bundy. I'm not saying you're Ted Bundy, but, well, if the false arm sling fits. The invincibility mode is a fine idea as far as I'm concerned. The more difficulty settings, from near insta-death unfair super hard modes right down to the never die eternal life modes, the better as far as I'm concerned. Customization, options, things to toggle on and off. These are part of what makes games fun, isn't it? Tailoring your experience? It's why mods are so popular, right? I mean, do you get pissy about your vanilla version of Fallout because someone else is playing against Randy Savage Deathclaws? You'd sound like an idiot protesting that. It's no different here. You don't have to play Star Fox Zero with an invincible ship. It won't be forced on you. It's not even default. And nobody's ever made you pick up that invulnerable Tanuki suit, even though we all know you've done it at least once. It's irrelevant if it's an option. Literally should not fucking matter to you. And yet it does. Why? Exclusion. That's all I can think of. It's the only reason I can come up with. People mad at optional difficulty settings are wanting exclusion. And we can see that in some of the malice tinging the comments. They put a baby mode in many of their games for people who suck. Get your warm bottles of milk ready. The babies are gonna need some pacifiers too. These people despise anybody who isn't hardcore like them and seem loath to share their space with them. All this mode is doing is opening Star Fox Zero to potential new crowds. casual gamers, young children, people with disabilities, and if you think that's a bad thing, like some of these comments seem to suggest, you're behaving like an elitist spoiled shit who is mad that you have to share your toys, which seems to be a running fucking theme among certain gamer crowds these days. Something like SFZ will only be bought by hardcore fans is part of that tweet I quoted at the top of this episode, and it speaks entirely to the myopic nature of this excluding sentiment. Because the invincibility mode, it's an answer to the idea that only hardcore fans would buy it. Now there's a chance other people will get into it too, and they'll have a chance to enjoy the game in a way that facilitates their progress and potentially get turned into new hardcore Star Fox fans. And that's a good thing. The more people playing and buying games is a good thing. Diverse audiences and a responding diversity of games to choose from is a good thing. A world of options and different flavours shouldn't be scary, and yet it is to some people, and that's just sad. Nobody's making you have hot gay sex in Dragon Age. Nobody's making you play Gone Home. Nobody's making you use an invincibility mode. You get to play any game you want in a way that makes you happy. Why the fuck aim to deprive others of the same? Probably because you're a prick. Sorry, but that's the blunt, short answer, mate. You're being a prick. And now I'm going to say something that'll really cheese some people's onions. Last time I said it, people got incredibly pissed off at me, but I still believe it, so here it goes. Come closer, come closer. I am fine with the idea of Dark Souls having an easy mode. Now look, I'd never use the easy mode. I love Dark Souls just the way it is, and I think easy mode players would need their own servers, or just not have full online functionality at all. But I'm not pissed at the suggestion of it. However, a few years back when series director Hidetaka Miyazaki said he was considering an easy mode, Dark Souls' notoriously impassioned fanbase was about ready to riot, and my suggestion soon after that, hey, maybe making Dark Souls accessible to new players and giving them a chance to become new fans wasn't the end of the world, remains one of the most bizarrely controversial and contrarian statements I've ever made. The counter-arguments were that it would ruin the game and undo the point of it, which, again, isn't the problem for anybody playing it on the regular mode. It's not your problem. It's not a problem. Your biggest problem is that someone who isn't as good as you at a game would enjoy the game. And if you're a fan of something, shouldn't you want as many people to enjoy it as possible to get that chance to upgrade themselves and become bigger fans? Actually, don't answer that. We all know how fandom can get about that sort of thing. I just wonder if you apply this shit to other areas of your life. Can you not stand to go bowling because sometimes there are kids using those gutter guards? Are you done with watching Stanley Kubrick films because there are detailed synopses explaining plot details for those who didn't get it? How about
No, I need you to go to the police station, ask about the journalist. His personal effects will have been impounded. Get hold of his diary or something that will tell us his movements.
We'll see Van Koon's PA. If we retrace their steps, somewhere they'll coincide.
Scotland Yard.
Flew back from Dalian Friday. Looks like he had back-to-back meetings with the sales team.
Can you print me up a copy?
Sure.
What about the day he died? Can you tell me where he was?
Sorry, bit of a gap. I have all his receipts.
Your friend.
Listen, whatever you say, I'm buttoned you 100%.
He's an arrogant sod.
Well, that was mild. People say a lot worse than that.
This is what you wanted, isn't it? The journalist's diary?
What kind of a boss was he, Amanda? Appreciative?
No, that's not a word I'd use. The only things Eddie appreciated had a big price tag.
Like that hand cream. He bought that for you, didn't he? This one. Got a taxi from home on the day he died, £18.50.
I would get him to the office.
Not rush hour, check the time. Mid-morning, 18, we get him as far as
the West End. I remember him saying.
Underground, printed at 1 in Piccadilly.
So So he got a tube back to the office. Why would he get a taxi into town and then the tube back?
Because he was delivering something heavy. You know, like a package up the escalator.
Delivering?
To someone near Piccadilly Station. Dropped the package, delivered it, and then stopped on his way. He got peckish.
So you brought your lunch from here en route to the station, but where were you headed from? Where did the taxi drop you?
Right. Eddie Van Coon brought a package here the day he died. Whatever was hidden inside that case, I've managed to piece together a picture using scraps of information. Sherlock. Credit card bills, receipts. He flew back from China, then he came here.
Sherlock.
Somewhere in this street, somewhere near, I don't know where, but...
That shop, over there.
How could you tell?
Lucas's diary, he was here too. He wrote down the address.
Oh.
You want Lucky Cat?
No, thanks, no.
£10. I think your wife, she will like.
Thank you.
Sherlock? The label there?
Yes, I see it.
Exactly the same as the cipher.
It's an ancient number system. Hangzhou. These days, only street traders use it. Those were numbers written on the wall at the bank and at the library. Numbers written in an ancient Chinese dialect.
It's a 15. What we thought was the artist's tag. It's a number 15.
And the blindfold, the horizontal line, that was a number as well. Chinese number one, John.
We found it.
Two men travel back from China. Both head straight for the Lucky Cat Emporium.
What did they see?
It's not what they saw. It's what they both brought back in those suitcases.
You don't mean duty free? Thank you.
Think about what Sebastian told us about Van Coon, about how he stayed afloat in the market.
Lost 5 million.
Made it back in a week. Mm. That's how he made such easy money.
He was a smuggler.
I reckon he would have been perfect. Businessman, making frequent trips to Asia. Lucas was the same, a journalist writing about China. Mm. Both of them smuggled stuff out. The Lucky Cat was their drop-off.
Why did they die? Well, it doesn't make sense. If they both turned up at the shop, delivered the goods, why would someone threaten them and kill them after the event, after they'd finished the job?
What if one of them was light-fingered?
How do you mean?
Stole something. Something from the hoard.
And the killer doesn't know which of them took it, so he threatens them both, right?
Remind me. When was the last time that it rained? It's been here since Monday. No one's been in that flat for at least 3 days.
They've gone on holiday.
You leave your windows open when you go on holiday.
Sherlock!
Someone else has been here. Somebody else broke into the flat and knocked over the vase, just like I did.